Senator Heinrich.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. You know, what I find fairly remarkable in this conversation is the amount of consensus from both our witnesses and from people on the dais here that we should simply set MOS standards based on the performance that we need for the job and then let the chips fall where they may. And sometimes that may, in the case, for example, of the Military Infantry Officer School, that's going to be some very, very difficult standards to meet. That said, I have no doubt that someday a woman is going to meet those standards. So, General Neller, I wanted to ask you, given your support, previous support for a waiver, do you have any concerns with that kind of approach of simply setting the bar where it needs to be for the performance that you need and then letting the chips fall where they may?
Well, Senator, it was brought up by Secretary Mabus, and it's a fact that part of the value of the evaluation we did was to come up with these standards.
Yeah.
So now we have these standards. I mean, there were always standards. There were standards because any of these Marines that were involved in the evaluation completed an MOS school, which had task condition standards to which they had to successfully complete. So it wasn't like there were no standards. To get it into the school, the females had to go and pass the male scoring on the male PFT and CFT. So where we are now is we have a decision. We made provide our best military judgment based on what we learned in an evaluation involving teams, crews, and squads, something that has never, ever been done, not just in the history of the United States, but from what we can tell, nowhere. No one ever looked at it in this way. That said, we have a decision, and we're in the process of moving out, and we have established a process to where any Marine who wants to serve in these physically demanding MOSs has to meet a certain standard. And we will see where the chips fall. And again, our hope is that everyone is successful, but hope is not a course of action on the battlefield. So we'll learn and we'll study and we'll do everything we can, because it's important, as General Milley brought up and everybody's brought up, that we have to be successful on a battlefield. And Marines have always been successful on a battlefield, and I'm confident we will in the future.
General, as you heard, Secretary Mabus brought up the fact that there were surprising gaps in set standards for some of these MOSs. Do you have an opinion as to what the impact on the service is going to be of simply on the core of clearly articulating the standards in all of these MOSs and how that will impact overall performance for the Corps moving forward?
I think based on the fact that we've set these standards and that the overall quality of the Marines that serve in these MOSs should be higher than it was in the past.
Great. Thank you. Secretary Mabus, I was hoping you could expand a little bit on what Senator Reid brought up around the transition, particularly within attack submarines, how that's going on the USS Mississippi, and how you feel about that process overall.
The process of integrating women onto all of our submarines, as you know, it started with ballistic missile, strategic submarines, and guided missile submarines. It's now moving to attack submarines. It's gone fine. And in all of these, the first two have completed a lot of cruises now. We've got a lot of experience under our belt. We've seen that women earn their dolphins at the same speed as men do in the submarine service. It's part of the implementation experience that we can bring to bear for this. Having a detailed implementation plan, having a well thought out way to do it, having a deliberate but timely way to do it. The attack submarines were done last because of the closer quarters, and a few, but only a few, physical changes had to be made. And we're very pleased not only with the integration of women officers, but the beginning of the integration of women enlisted on all types of Navy submarines.
Well, thank you, Secretary, for your work on that.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thanks to all of you for your service to our country and for your testimonies today. This is a subject like so many others that we cover on this committee that's of exceptional importance to our country, to our national security. As we approach this issue, which is fraught with a lot of opinions, a lot of facts, a lot of details, I hope that we will maintain our focus on maintaining the readiness and the capability of our men and women in service, and especially on the safety of the men and women who protect us. First of all, General Milley, I wanted to follow up on a question that was asked by Senator Ernst to General Neller. She asked General Neller whether women might be involuntarily transferred into some of these combat positions against their will. Do you want to provide an answer from the Army perspective?
I'm going to have to give you it depends. Right now, we have no requirement because we're filling our needs for the infantry and both officer and enlisted. And currently, we do not involuntarily put anyone in the infantry. But we are meeting our needs. 10 years, 15, 20 years in the future, you know, it depends. So look back at World War II. A lot of people were involuntarily put in the infantry. So, but right now, we do not, and I don't anticipate that situation at any time in the near future.
Okay, thank you. General Neller, the Marine Corps report stated that there were some noticeable differences in performance between all male squads on the one hand and those that were gender integrated, not just squads but teams and crews as well. In your professional military opinion, could you tell us what were the most notable reasons for these differences, and then also whether these are factors that could easily be remedied through training and improved techniques and processes?
Senator, when we put together the Ground Combat Element Integrated Task Force, there were infantry, and in infantry you have mortars, you have machine guns, you have rockets, you have TOWs. There were tank crews, artillery crews, amphibian vehicle crews, and light armor vehicle crews. So in each of those, there were some number of differences between the integrated and the all-male crews, squads, or teams, but the two that were most significant, what we would call load-bearing units or the infantry. March under load with a weighted load over a distance, and then the other was during a movement, fire and movement drill with load. As you get fatigued, the effect on your accuracy when you fired your weapon. So the study showed two things. Under the march under load, that the heavier the load, the more degraded the ability of the integrated squads. And then when you would do movement to contact, the accuracy of the integrated squads and the firing of females due to physiological things that are documented was lower.
And are those things that can be remedied through improved training and techniques?
I think to some degree, but a lot of it's, we learned that, you know, being, and the same applies to anyone of a smaller stature, being big, strong, having a certain body mass gives you an advantage. So one of the things I've heard as I've gone around and talked to female Marines is, hey, I'm out working out, I'm lifting weights, I'm getting bigger, and now I'm outside the height and weight standards. Are you going to change the height and weight standards? And we're looking at that right now. So we know that mean body mass has an effect on your ability to carry a load. As far as the conditioning and your ability to have a higher level of energy and exert yourself, that's what we're going to find out, what we're going to learn. And again, we did this for just 5 months. We don't know, you know, what is this going to do over years and years and years of being in these particular occupational fields. We know anecdotally what the effect is on the male body, and we don't have data yet, and we eventually we will, on what the impact is on the female.
My understanding is that one of the findings in the report that was released by the Marine Corps indicated some evidence of higher injury rates among women than men when asked to perform the same tactical tasks. So can you tell us how this factor, when extrapolated across combat units in the Marine Corps, can you tell us how that might impact your overall military readiness and capability and how you could deal with that?
We know from data that we have now for certain points of training that female Marines suffer a higher incidence of injury, normally lower body injury, than men. So part of the review, not just for body size and height and weight, is also conditioning. So the one way we believe we can do this is through better preparation, better conditioning, to mitigate that. So that's something we don't know what we don't know, and that'll be one of the things that we're going to have to continue to study and monitor as we go through this.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Before beginning my questions, I have to, I can't resist pointing out that 40 years ago, I sat back where you folks are sitting, and my boss, Senator Bill Hathaway from Maine, led the effort to open the military academies to women, which at the time was a radical idea. So there's some history here for me in this conversation. It seems to me that this is really about talent pool. Mr. Secretary, you mentioned that. Mr. Secretary, you also mentioned it. We need the best people we can get, whoever they are, wherever they come from. And the shocking figure that we've already discussed today is that only one out of four young people is qualified for military service, either for physical other kinds of intellectual issues. We need people. And the secret of the success of this country, in my opinion, is access and opening up access to more and more people. And I have no doubt that limiting access to virtually any job, to eliminating 50% of the talent pool is always a bad policy. The question, it seems to me, though, is how do we design gender-neutral standards that are, in fact, gender-neutral, but also meet the requirements of the job? And that's going to be the challenge. General Neller, I thought your exchange with Senator Lee was very informative, and the issue, for example, of weight. I visited the Marine Corps Officer School in Quantico and saw what those young people have to carry. As I recall, the lightest pack was something like 75 pounds, and they go up from there. I think your response was an important one, that this could be a question of A, who physically can do it regardless of gender, and B, training and readiness over a period of time. I think the great danger, though, is that we don't let the standards diminish in order to meet some kind of arbitrary requirements. The word goals has been used here. Goals, unfortunately, can often turn into quotas. And, Mr. Secretary, I presume that that is not your intention in any way, shape, or form.
Absolutely not, Senator. Number one, it'd go against the law. But number two, you cannot lower standards. This is not about quotas. It's not about equality of outcome. It's about equality of opportunity. And you've got to keep those standards. You've got to keep them job-related. You've got to keep them very rigorous. And you've got to evolve those standards as our threats and as our challenges evolve. But they've got to evolve for everybody.
I would assume that the performance of women in these very rigorous top-end MOSs, Ranger School, Marine training, will improve over time as they are given the opportunity to set their sights on that career. General Milley, would you agree with that?
I would expect that to be true over time as women's experience and those skills is expanded over time. Absolutely.
And it seems to me, General Nello, that may be one of the answers to the data that you developed in this initial study, because it was an initial study. In other words, you didn't have 2, 3, 4, 5, 10 years of women who had worked through this process. Would you agree that that may be the case?
We would have liked to have had more time to look at this, because I think anyone that does this type of analysis would tell you that, you know, a year long is not enough to draw a lot of conclusions. We have the data that we have. So that's why, Senator, part of our implementation process is a continuing analysis of a whole number of variables and factors. And I do, though, agree that, you know, the women that are in the Marine Corps today are very different, not that the ones that were there before were not of quality and great our nation well, but the overall quality of Marines in general is much higher than it was when I joined this organization 40 years ago. And our hope is, you know, people will maybe see this as an opportunity and then they'll want to compete, whatever it is. So I think, you know, I mean, I've got a daughter, you know. I raised my daughter in the way I raised my daughter. She's very competitive. And I think, you know, people raise their girls, females, Americans, they do different things than they did 30 years ago. It's a different place. So we'll find out. That said, there are certain physiological differences that exist. There are always going to be people on that that are outliers. I think what Senator Ernst asked me was a fair question. Where does the top of the women capability overlap with the male capability? And is that going to make them competitive in the long run? We're going to find that out. But that's part of what we don't know.
And it seems to me part of what this whole...
Time has expired.
I'm sorry.
Senator Fisher, with Senator Sessions' indulgence.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and my thanks to Senator Sessions. I need to get to the chamber to preside, but I did want to ask a few questions here. When we're going to be looking at monitoring the implementations, how well prepared do you think we are at that process, specifically with regards to making changes? If I could ask Secretary Murphy and Secretary Mabus about that, how do the services plan to track the outcomes of the changes and ensure that when we see any unintended consequences come forward, that we can act on those promptly and be able to address any concerns that we see? Secretary Murphy, if you'd like to begin.
Thanks, Senator. As we said, Senator, we're going to have general neutral operational relevant standards with no quotas whatsoever. But as the Army, we assess everything as we move forward. We assess physical fitness, how you're doing your job, OERs, et cetera. So we will continue to assess this as we move forward and make sure that we're doing what's necessary to accomplish our mission, and that's to fight and win our nation's wars.
And do you have that in your implementation plan? It's always good to say you're going to be flexible, you're going to be able to address it, but are there really steps that are laid out in your plans?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
I would also like to, the chief could respond as well, that would be helpful.
Okay. If we could have Secretary Mabus first, please.
As part of the formal process of looking at this continually, one of the things that is required by the law, and one of the things that's in everybody's implementation plan, is that the Inspector General of each service will look at, number one, whether these standards continue to be validated, job-oriented, mission-specific, gender-neutral, but number two, what are the results of this integration? The first report is to be undertaken this year as we begin the integration process, and each service has already ordered that review to go forward. Past that, as Secretary Murphy has very correctly pointed out, we're always looking at every single standard as threats evolve. As I said in my opening statement, infantry school today is very different than it was just 25 years ago because our threats have changed, and we're going to continue to do that. And that's one of the things I think that Marines do exceptionally well. They adapt, they improvise, and they overcome. Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. In general, would you like to add any comments?
Just briefly, we have developed explicit, written, gender-neutral task conditions and standards for every MOS in the United States Army right now, today. And when we execute for the infantry, armor, and special forces, those will be implemented, they'll be tested, and they'll be validated, and they'll be monitored closely. Secretary of Defense has established a Secretary of Defense level organization to monitor implementation. We've done the same thing at the Secretary of the Army, the Department of the Army Secretariat, and we'll be doing routine, read monthly and quarterly, monitoring of implementation and execution of this. Training and Doctrine Command, United States Army, has primary responsibility for phases 1 and 2. Our plan is 4 phases, and phases 3 and 4, primary responsibility is to General Abrams and Forces Command, which is the operational force. And that'll be coming up next year and the year after that. So it's very rigorous program of implementation and monitoring.
And thank you for that very clear explanation. I appreciate it. General Neller, you had mentioned before that the Marines had studied some foreign militaries and what they have done with the integration of their women into the combat positions. Can you comment on any of the findings that you had?
We looked at the Canadian, the Australian, the UK, and the Israeli militaries. The first three have integrated these MOSs. The numbers are very small, but the lessons they learned in speaking to the service members there that have been part of that was leadership, maintenance of standards, setting up a cohort or some number of people to support so that the individual females in this case didn't go down there completely cold. But the number one thing was the standards. They also mentioned the potential benefits of gender separate recruit training. The Israelis, I believe, had done this at one time, and then they have walked away from it. They do have one predominantly female border unit, but they do not allow women to be assigned in these combat MOSs, infantry, armor, or airborne.
What would be their reasons for that with the Israelis? Is it due to the standards that are in place, or is it concern about the neighborhood they live in?
I think there's a number of reasons, Senator, but I think one is they're just trying to take and make the best use of the talent of the population that they have. So if you go to an Israeli school that teaches these, the majority of the instructors are females teaching ground combat things.
Thank you, sir, very much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Senator Sessions.
On behalf of the chairman, let me recognize Senator Kane.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and to all of our witnesses. This is an important issue, and I echo what Senator Heinrich said about the degree of consistency among the witnesses and folks here serving. A story that I find relevant. Women were not allowed to run the marathon in the Olympics until 1984. There was a belief that physically they would not be able to run it. The longest race for women in the 1980 Olympics in Moscow was a 1,500 meter, and even that was somewhat recent. It had been an 800 meter was the longest race a woman could run. Today, 30 years later, the men's world record in the marathon is 2 hours and 3 minutes, and the women's world record in the marathon is 2 hours and 15 minutes. There's an advantage to men, but that women's world record time would have won the gold record in the men's marathon during most of the history of the Olympics. And now, and this is a joke, the marathon's for wimps now, because now there's ultramarathons. One common ultramarathon event is a 2-day run, 48-hour run. Men have the edge on the track. The woman's record is 370 kilometers in 2 days, and the men's record is 430 kilometers in 2 days, so if it's just a run. But there's another one that's kind of interesting to me. How fast can you through-hike the Appalachian Trail, 2,200 miles, And there's a record for doing it all on your own, not having support, having to carry everything, big backpack, carry it all. The men's record is 58 days. The woman's record is 54 days. The woman has the record for the having to carry it all. Combat and military service is different. But what this tells me is, and General Nello, you kind of talked about it, daughters raised today are going to be raised different than daughters 30 years ago. When there's a social cap or ceiling or limitation, that sort of gets absorbed by people, and they don't even focus on what they might be able to do. They get raised in a particular way with the thought that that cap is going to be there. When the cap is lifted, all of a sudden, there's all kinds of possibilities, and people start to focus on opportunities they might have and train themselves up for them. And just like when you lift the ban on running the marathon in the Olympics and allow women to do it, suddenly they're fantastic marathoners, ultra-marathoners, AT hikers with packs. Parenthetically, the physiological difference in women in carrying weight leads a lot of backpack manufacturers to make different packs for women where that can actually erase some of that physiological difference. I have a high confidence in the American military and all the service branches to do this. Because you always are super can-do, and you always figure it out. I mean, I have that confidence in you. And one of my kids, as some of you know, has been through ROTC and OCS and TBS and IOC with women. It's more of a norm now than an earlier generation of Marines. And he understands how hard it is for everybody and that this will be a challenge to implement. But this is a can-do operation that's going to figure it out. And I have complete confidence in that. I'm kind of interested in the topic of standard setting, and General Nello, you talked a little bit about this. I tried to write this quickly down. You talked about in preparing for integration of women in MOSs and studying it, you did a lot of studies of the standards, and I think you said because of our standard setting, our overall quality will be higher for men and women. I'd kind of like to ask all of you, was the standard setting that you did and analyzed around the integration question, set aside integration of women into MOSs, did it have strong independent value for your service branches to do that standard setting and analysis exercise in terms of figuring out what the right requirements for the MOSs are given the nature of contemporary warfare? And that's a question I'd like each of you to address.
The standards that we established were established on 30 September, actually before a decision was made, because we recognized as part of the analysis that whether there was going to be an exception granted or not, we needed to have a more performance-related standard. I mean, there's training, the things you did, but so we actually codified it. And so since that time, the men that have gone through infantry training battalion, armor school, artillery school, engineer school, have been getting their MOS qualifications based on this standard. And the completion rate's been, 99%+. So that just goes to the overall quality of the Marine that we're getting now. I have every confidence that if there is a female Marine out there who can meet the other standards before they come into recruit training or what they have to do at entry level training or recruit training, we'll find out. We'll know. Because the females that did go through this training and get awarded the MOS, they didn't have to do this. So we don't know yet what we don't know, but I believe that that'll be, it's something, there are things you can train to, but you have to have the physiological capability to move fast and bear a load and lift heavy weights.
I see my time has expired. Thank you.
Thank you. On behalf of the Chairman, Senator Sessions.
Thank you very much, and thank all of you for sharing your thoughts with us on this important matter. General Neller, the Marine Corps did a study and completed it in 2015, is that correct? And what was the purpose of that study?
Senator, the purpose of the study was after Secretary Panetta in January 2013 stated that there was going to be no exception for gender to assignment to MOSs in unit and gave the services a period of time to take a look at this. It was the final process of what we did. We first put female Marines in previously restricted units and MOSs that they had. We sent 448 females through Infantry Training Battalion to see how they would do, and then we realized we couldn't assign them to a unit, so we had to create a unit, and we wanted to see how they did in the context, not just meeting individual standards, but how they would function within a squad, team, or a crew.
And do you feel like that was, as reasonably as you can, a fair analysis of the challenges that you'd be facing if you move to integration of combat units?
The evaluation was designed to try to replicate as best we could in a live fire environment those types of skills or tasks that you would have to do in combat.
Now, the purpose of the report says this, quote, central to this historic research effort has been the clear recognition that the brutal and extremely physical nature of direct ground combat, often marked by close interpersonal violence, remains largely unchanged throughout the centuries of warfare despite technological advancements, close quote. You've served a long time in the Marine Corps. You agree with that?
The character war may have changed, but the overall nature of war, depending upon the fight you're in, at the end of the day, can still come down to that type of an environment. Yes, Senator.
Now, the report said this, the Marine Corps fights as units. Therefore, developing and maintaining the most combat-effective units must always be at the forefront of any contemplated institutional change. Do you agree with that?
I do.
And do you agree with the report's finding, quote, combat effectiveness, the health and welfare of individual Marines, and talent management are, close quote, are key evaluating factors on performance?
Those are three of the major lenses through which we looked at the report and looked through implementation.
Well, here are the summary of the research findings. See if they're inconsistent with your experience in the Marine Corps. Overall, quote, all male squads, teams, and crews demonstrated higher performance levels on 69% of the tasks evaluated, that's 134 tasks, as compared to gender-integrated squads, teams, and crews. The integrated squads were superior in two events out of the 134. The rest, I guess, were equal. Do you dispute that, or is that consistent with your experience?
That's the data that we derive from the evaluation.
Speed is important in combat. Quote, all male squads, regardless of infantry MOS, were faster than the gender integrated squads in each tactical movement. Lethality, all male 0311 squads, that's the infantry rifleman squads, quote, had better accuracy compared to gender integrated squads. There was notable difference between genders for every individual weapon system except the probability of hit and miss with the M4, that's the individual carbine. Is that what the report found, and do you dispute that?
No, sir, that's accurate as to what we found.
Also, it found all male infantry crew-served weapons teams engaged targets quicker and registered more hits on target as compared to gender-integrated infantry crew-served weapons teams, with the exception of M2 accuracy. Is that part of the report?
It is.
All male squads, teams, and crews, and gender-integrated squads, teams, and crews had a noticeable difference in their performance of the basic combat task of negotiating obstacles and evacuating casualties. Well, let me just, so that's the combat lethality question. Health and welfare of the Marines themselves, you put them in very stressful positions. Quote, in addition to performance, evidence of higher injury rates for females when compared to males performing the same tactical task were noted. Within the research at the Infantry Training Battalion, females undergoing that entry-level training were injured at 6 times the rate of male counterparts. Is injury rates a factor you need to consider when you put people through training?
Yes, Senator.
During the assessment, quote, musculoskeletal injury rates were 40% for females compared to 18% for males. And one more thing that, you know, people talk about, we can't let it dominate our thinking, but how do you evaluate all of that? I mean, how do you evaluate the risk of injury and the ability to perform effectively on the battlefield when you consider the integration of combat forces? You made that recommendation, you made your recommendation, but how do you evaluate that?
Well, Senator, to evaluate it, I mean, we're going to find out. This is part of what we found out, and also what we found out that we believe that there's ways that this can be, to some degree, mitigated. How much? You know, we don't know what we don't know. So the physical capability of the individual Marine, their susceptibility to injury, their overall fitness, this is all part of the evaluation that everyone has talked about, and General Milley stated down there. We've got very specific questions and areas that we're going to monitor as we go through this implementation process.
Well, I've served in the Army Reserve Unit for 10 years with fabulous women soldiers and officers. Commander of that unit now is the first one that's received 2 stars in the unit's history. She's a 2-star general and doing a great job. And we have tremendous military soldiers and officers who are women, and it's an important part of the military. And I think you're wise to do this careful evaluation, and let's see how we can continue that tradition in the most smartest way.
On behalf of the chairman, Senator Hirono.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You were just asked a series of questions relating to differences in performance of women and men. And I think, General Miller, you indicated that there may be ways to mitigate these performance differences. But I'm wondering, did you come to the conclusion that, you know, we always have to worry about attributing cause and effect to any performance differences. So did you come to a conclusion that there's something innately about being a female that causes these kinds of differences in performance? Have you come to that conclusion?
Senator, I think the data, not just from this evaluation, but data that exists throughout sports world or other place, that there are physiological differences between the average male and the average female. Now, the question is, to what degree can we mitigate that? So the conclusion, if we've come to anything, is, hey, these are things that we need to pay attention to. Now, whether they'll manifest themselves in the future or not, we will find that out.
So in those instances where what we're measuring is something that requires physical strength, then there's innately, I mean, there will be some women who are physically a lot stronger than men, but as a general proposition, that where physical strength is measured, women will come out, they will be less able to perform. That's the conclusion you've drawn.
On the average, yes.
So when we talk about gender-neutral standards, let me turn to that. because nobody here is talking about lowering of standards, but there are some concerns that some of these standards that relate to performance necessary for the job may be unnecessarily high or inaccurate. We're not talking about lowering of standards. So my question is, how are these standards validated? Who validates these standards for the various for the Marines, for the Army? Secretary Mabus, would you like to respond to that?
The uniform head of each service validates that they are occupationally relevant, that they are mission-oriented, and that they are gender-neutral.
I think that though that may be difficult really to measure. So I think what I heard you saying is that the implementation and to make sure that these standards actually are required for a performance on the job, that there will be monitoring and reevaluation of these standards, because one hopes that standards are somehow set in a neutral objective body. So, in addition to the physical standards that must be met, I assume that in a combat situation, one also cares about things such as the mental state of the person or the judgment of the person. Are those part of the MOS standards?
The MOS standards for the entry level, there's a basic general technical classification test score that you have to meet. And so when you go to your academic part of your training, and there's academics in any of these, and someone for gunnery and artillery and tanks is very complicated and involves mathematics and things. So there is an intellectual piece to this, to where, you know, you're gonna find out some people may be superior in this area. But at the basic level, at the entry level, whether it's an infantry platoon commander or a junior Marine or soldier in a squad, the physical requirements that they have to perform are, you can't ignore those facts. Now, as people become more senior, then it starts to balance out, and your ability to exercise judgment and your ability to make decisions, that may become more important, but it doesn't remove the requirement for the physical requirements that you have to perform. So to the point on who validates, mm-hmm. You know, we've looked at this. We have training commands who have an analyst and people that do this for a profession. We know exactly from every step what you have to do to load a howitzer, to load a tank, to lift, you know, it's very mundane stuff, Senator, like, mm-hmm. Hey, you have to lift an artillery round, yes, that weighs 98 pounds up to the truck. And you have to do that. So there are certain fundamental tasks to be part, yes, of a tank crew, a gun crew, to be in a rifle squad. And so those were the things that we looked at that we thought were the mission essential tasks to be effective in these MOSs. And we've had third parties look at this because we wanted to ensure that the standards were valid and they weren't too high or too low.
Senator Tillis.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Actually, I want to continue maybe along that line of questioning. You know, one of the things that I've had in my discussions with some of you and others is that this process has been good and that it's really made you think about documenting and setting standards for things that you kind of knew you had to do, but you hadn't articulated them. So that's healthy. To what extent, and then I've had other discussions said that, and when we've looked at it, maybe we need to raise the standards a little bit. To what extent do we run the risk of being able to do that because it appears to be lessening or diminishing our opportunity to provide women more opportunities in combat positions, which I happen to support? General Noller, you want to start with that?
Senator, I think the standards, can't speak for the Army, but I looked at their standards, and their standards they're different, but they're also, I think, fairly demanding and would show a high probability of being able to be successful in any of these ground combat MOSs, whether they be load-bearing MOSs or non-load-bearing. So whether they're too low or too high, we've done an analysis as to where, what is, you know, kind of the average. This is, we're producing a large number of Marines to do these things, in the Army an even larger number. So we're looking for that point to where it's, you have to do this in order to be effective and be effective within the team. And there are always going to be individuals that fall across the spectrum on that scatter chart.
And General Milley, maybe if you respond to that, you could share whether or not you can think, as you're going through this and thinking about women playing or having increasing opportunities in combat roles, can you think of any physical standards that you think should be lowered?
Physical standards, but let me make a comment on standards, though. I don't want anybody in the committee to think that either the Army or the Marines or the Navy or the Air Force didn't have standards until we suddenly went through this. The United States Army's had standards since Baron von Steuben showed up at Valley Forge. We're a standards-based Army. We're a standards-based military, always have been. And they're written down, and they're codified, and we adjust them over time based on the realities of battlefield, new technologies, et cetera, et cetera. In this particular case, for infantry and armor, we have developed a new set of gender-neutral standards. And those are measured against one thing, neither male nor female. They're measured against the requirements of combat. And they've been, to answer Senator Hero's comment, those have been rigorously reviewed. We'll be glad to provide them, peer-reviewed through all kinds of technical analysis. But we are definitely standards-based. These are rigorous, and they'll be fairly applied to both males and females.
General Neller, the Marines have the entry-level recruit training. It's segregated. I guess it's on a glide path to be integrated. Do you believe that that's a good idea?
I think we have to wait till next
month. I wouldn't describe it as segregated. I wouldn't describe it as segregated. We, at entry level, at recruit training at MCRD Paris Island, we allow our female Marines to train separately, and then as they get further into the training, they do more and more integrated training with the male recruits.
What, in your professional military opinion, are the benefits of that approach?
I know what I think.
Because of the data we have on the physical differential, and because of the opportunity for these female recruits to be led by female drill instructors and female officers, they see females as role models. There's no distraction. They're allowed to compete. They see other women that can lead and compete. They get an opportunity to improve their physical fitness, and then it gives them an opportunity to gain some confidence before they would then be put in, as they're going to be eventually. I mean, once they graduate as Marines, every part of our training, from Marine combat training to your MLS training to the operational force, is fully integrated, men and women serving side by side.
Do you agree with some do that it sets them up to actually better compete for those positions as they progress through their training?
My personal view right now is at the beginning, that initial part is critical and sets them up for success.
And Mr. Chair, I'll just close with this comment. I'd like to get from the secretaries, given the work that's been done, the policy that's being implemented, some understanding of what the long-term cost could potentially be as we implement this program, anything from MILCON cost to health care costs, a number of other factors. We've heard numbers about injury rates, a number of other things. I'm assuming that was looked at before the policy recommendations were put into place, and I'd like to get that information. We'll make a request to your agencies. Thank you.
Senator Blumenthal.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for holding this hearing. I want to thank all of the witnesses who are here today for your extraordinary service to our nation and for your very thoughtful and insightful testimony today. In the military, as elsewhere, women are breaking down barriers and proving they're equally capable professionally and personally, and I happen to believe that our military will be made stronger by the policies that you are implementing. Policies that are the result of planning and action that began in 2012, and our military will be made stronger as we open billets to women without lowering standards and without imposing quotas. And I think, Secretary Mabus, you made that point extremely well, and I'm going to quote it again: lowering standards would be unacceptable to every Marine, especially those women who choose to compete for these positions. I think that's a very profoundly important point here, that women do not want standards lowered. They don't want outcomes dictated or quotas for positions. It's simply about equal access, in fact, with higher standards, not lower standards. And the other point that you made very well, I thought, Secretary Mabus, is that this is not about women in combat. Women have been serving in combat and have been proving themselves in combat. In fact, they've served, for example, in Iraq, in the Lioness program, where female Marines and soldiers volunteered to join combat troops at checkpoints and conducted outreach operations with Iraqi women. I remember listening to Admiral McRaven describe the role that women play with his special forces teams in both Iraq and Afghanistan. And I'm very proud of the work that they have done in the Army as well. U.S. Army Special Operations Command created an all-woman cultural support team to work along with Green Berets and Army Rangers in combat zones. And just last year, women again proved they're capable of competing in combat positions by meeting the grueling gender-neutral standards required to pass Army Ranger schools, including a native of Connecticut, Orange, Connecticut, Captain Kristen Griest. I want to ask a question that focuses on a different part of this process. As a ranking member of the Veterans Affairs Committee, whether we are doing enough to plan, both the Department of Defense and the VA, for the cooperation that's necessary to meet the needs of our women veterans after they leave the service. Connecticut just opened a women's health care center within the West Haven facility, a profoundly important step forward, but many facilities, hospital facilities and others around the country, have failed to provide those women-oriented health care centers, and they require specialties that are not present for men. So I'd like to ask that question generally of this panel, whether there has been sufficient planning, what more should be done for our women veterans.
Well, Senator, as you very correctly pointed out, women have been serving for a long time with distinction and are becoming an ever-increasing part of our veterans community. And we owe all of our veterans that have served us so well that standard of care. And I think that, speaking for the Defense Department, we're trying to make it more seamless as you leave the service and you move into the VA system. We're trying to make it more an easier process, a process that doesn't put the members under stress. But to a point that Secretary Murphy made a good bit earlier, you know, now 18% of Navy is female. At the Naval Academy this year, it's 29% that are female, and it's going up every year. And so that's something we've got to pay very close attention to, not only while people are in, but as they transition back to civilian life.
Senator Ayotte.
Thank you, Chairman. I want to thank each of you for your leadership and service to our nation. I fully support giving women the opportunity to both meet and exceed the high standards set by each of our branches of the military. But as the chair of the Readiness Committee, what I would like as a commitment from each of you is that as we implement this policy, that we ensure that individual and unit standards are focused solely on combat readiness and nothing else. And I think the women of this nation would want that. I think the women who are going to have the opportunity and who have served so admirably and defended this nation already in combat would want that. So I want to make sure that I have the assurance of each of you that that will be the case.
Yes, Senator.
Absolutely.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, Senator.
Thank you. I want to bring up an issue. When we talk about women serving in our military, that is really one that has bothered me. And that is that we have women guards who are guarding the prisoners and terrorists at Guantanamo. And they are women who are fully qualified, capable, and to guard anyone there. Yet there has been a court order in place since January of last year for, in particular, the 9/11 terrorists that essentially says that the women who are guards there are not permitted to actually transport the 9/11-5 to legal meetings and commission proceedings. And Senator Ernst and Senator Scott and I went to Guantanamo. We met with the women guards there. And I can assure you what they told us is, we just want to do our jobs. So as we are here having a hearing today on women, giving women an opportunity in all billets in the military, here we have a billet that women are already serving, and yet there's a court order in place that I believe OSD has not stepped up aggressively enough to stand up for the rights of our women in the military to perform their jobs, and that we've essentially let terrorists dictate terms that are completely unreasonable, not based on any religious views, even though they're claiming it. And you know, your predecessor, not your predecessor, but one of your the former commander of Southcom, General Kelly, was very upset about this. Brought this to my attention. Previously, Secretary Carter's been before this committee and also described this as outrageous. So I would like to know, especially General Milley, most of these women guards serve in the Army, and Secretary Murphy as well. But all of you, what do you think about this? And shouldn't we be more aggressively standing up for the rights of our women in the military to do their jobs rather than what exists right now, which is the right of the 9/11 terrorists that are bogus in terms of the ability of our women to do their jobs in the military? So I want to get your comment on this.
I personally think it's ridiculous that these women are not allowed to do that job. I probably have other words that can't be said behind this microphone right now about how I feel about that whole situation. But I agree with you, Senator.
Senator, I concur with the chief, and let me be clear, we don't take orders from the terrorists, but there was a court order here, and we take an oath to support and defend the Constitution. But I will tell you, ma'am, that I will go back. I'm now 4 weeks into this job. I'll go back and meet with our general counsel, Alyssa Starzak, and look at this issue and report back to you.
I would appreciate it, because I've been completely unsatisfied, having been a former prosecutor myself, with the level of defense that has been given and advocacy on behalf of our women in the military here. So I hope you will do that, please. Secretary Mabus?
I share exactly your words. It's outrageous. Women need to be able to do the jobs that they are qualified to do.
Senator, I agree with the rest of the panel.
Thank you all, and I do appreciate your willingness to pursue this, Secretary Murphy, because I think we can do a much better job for standing up for their rights as opposed to what's in place right now, that to me, to let these 9/11 terrorists dictate what our women in the military can do is outrageous. Thank you.
Senator Gillibrand.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We've had a lot of discussion about the Marine Corps assessment, and I want to clarify something. I think we can all agree that the women who volunteered to do the ground combat element in integrated task force assessment were exceptional in their willingness to participate in a study that they were not specifically trained for and did not have the experience necessary to actually compete in that study effectively. The design of this research overall was very flawed. First of all, these female Marines were screened for the basic physical fitness test, but were competing in a large part with male Marines who had years of experience and training, and many of them in combat positions. Further, there was no bar that the groups competed had to meet. Rather, they were competing against each other. So all we really know from this study is that groups that had the right experience and training and more training did better. We don't actually have data that can be used because these women who were asked to participate did not have the same training and experience than those who had been doing it for a long time. And similarly, on the injury rates, for those women who did do this, they only had the basic standard PT test. They didn't do specific training to do these missions and to complete them. So I just want my colleagues to fully understand that this assessment isn't designed to give us the data that we actually need. I think it's fundamentally flawed. So Secretary Mavis, I'd like your view on that, and then General Neller, I'd like your view on that.
When Secretary Panetta and Chairman of the Joint Chiefs Dempsey set us on this road, they said that the default position, that the assumption was that every position would be opened and that any sort of exception would have to be very narrowly tailored and would have to be based on job-specific individual standards. And the Marine test, as I've said here before, did one great thing that General Neller has talked about, and that is it codified the standards that each individual Marine in a unit had to meet in order to get that that MOS. But I think we have to focus on individuals. If an individual meets that standard, if an individual meets the gender-neutral, combat-specific, job-specific standard, then that person should get to do the job.
Well, I just think that the too many of the senators who were listening to that summary of what the Marine study showed are having a misimpression. We're not comparing average women to average men. We are talking about extraordinary women. And if you look at the three women who just completed Ranger School, these three women are extraordinary women. And so if we were to assess, can they do the job? Yes, they can do the job. But again, to base too much or to rely too much on a study that didn't have that level of training and rigor ahead of time so that they had the same experience, the same background, it's unfair to draw too many conclusions from it, is all I want to say. I just hope you don't draw your conclusions. And it also, no one mentioned the fact that when they actually tested for complex problem-solving tasks, the mixed units did better. So there's an area where women are improving the results of these units. And we all know that combat is going to continue to become more and more complex over time. Warfare is going to continue to become more and more complex over time. So please don't lose sight of the assets that these extraordinary women are going to bring to your missions. They have skills beyond what a typical Marine may have. And so that is going to enhance what you'll be able to do long term. General Neller, I'd love your thoughts too.
Well, Senator, first of all, I think it would be unfair to any of those Marines, but particularly the females that participated in the GCEITF, to say they weren't trained. They all went to MOS school, and so they received and have now received the MOS, whether it's infantry, artillery, armor. When I look at their physical data on the male PFT, pretty consistent. The one differential was in pull-ups. But as you said, these were exceptional female Marines. They did not have to do this. They volunteered. They did our Corps, our country, a great service, and we owe them a debt of gratitude. And that's one of the reasons their unit received a meritorious unit commendation at the conclusion of their training. Now, after they went to this MOS training, they were formed into this Ground Combat Element Task Force for 4 months of preparatory training, where they trained with men and developed the skills that they needed to go do this evaluation.
But the 4 months doesn't compare to the years that a lot of these units had been already working together doing this MOS.
None of these Marines had been in this unit. This was a formed unit. But it is fair to say, I will agree with you, that their experience in these MOSs was probably not up to the level of their male counterparts. But in every other standard that I can tell, I would say that they were as, you know, as good, if not better, in overall quality in their service as their male Marine counterparts.
Thank you.
So do you believe that the study was fatally flawed?
Sir, I do not. We've had the study peer-reviewed by numerous groups.
So you think it was a legitimate study?
Within the time we had, yes, Chairman.
Senator Sullivan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I appreciate the hearing. Appreciate all of you testifying today on a very, very important issue, but I think from your testimony and the questions you're seeing from the members of this committee, it's certainly not an easy issue. You're talking about schools. I happen to have been through the Marine Infantry Officer course, a recon school, Sears school. These are very difficult schools that most men have a hard time with because it's about a tough profession. I think Sergeant Major LaHue, when he was talking about this recently, the Marine Corps Sergeant Major put it very succinctly, in regards to infantry, there's no trophy for second place. You perform or die. Serious, serious discussion here. And I'm a Marine Infantry Officer, but like General Neller mentioned, I'm also someone who has three daughters, three teenage daughters. All their lives, my wife and I have been telling them that if they work hard, earn something, that they should be able to do anything anyone else does, anyone. So I support the opportunity for women to serve in any capacity in the military as long as the standards are not lowered. And I think you're seeing that as a consensus here. But what one thing that hasn't been talked about enough, I want to talk a little bit about the process. And we know that Secretary Panetta allowed the services to request an exemption. And after thorough study with hundreds of Marines and men and women serving, gave their all to put together a study. Secretary Mabus, I have to tell you, I've been very disappointed in terms of the process, how you've dealt with the Marine Corps' desire to look at this really difficult issue. As soon as the Marines published their study, within 24 hours of this 1,000-page study, you came out and said you saw no reason for an exemption. Did you read the study?
Senator, what I said countless times since the time that Secretary Panetta and Chairman Dempsey had done it, had set us on this path, that the presumption was that we were
You said, I do not see any reason for an exemption the day after this study was published. Based on what?
The conclusions.
Did you read the study?
I have read the study.
Did you read the study before you stated that?
I had read the conclusions that the Marines drew from the study prior to that, and those conclusions, which were based on averages and not on individual Marines.
Let me ask another question that related to the study, and Senator Gillibrand just talked about it. You then implied that the women Marines involved in the study weren't the top flight Marines. And General Neller, I think, just said that wasn't the case. And then in public radio, you essentially told the American people that the Marines weren't looking at this in an objective manner. You said, quote, it started out with a fairly large component of the men in the Marine Corps thinking that this is not a good idea and women will never be able to do this. When you start out with that mindset, you are almost presupposing the outcome. I think the only person presupposing the outcome in this entire process was you. General Neller, were you presupposing the outcome on this after millions of dollars and hundreds of Marines to put together this report? Is that what you were doing, sir?
We were all waiting for the results of the study, but I think we'd been out and visited and we had seen some things, but there was a lot of analysis that had to be done, and it was a short period of time. But no, I was not presupposing it.
Let me just make another point. I think Secretary Mabus, for whatever reason, you've seemed agitated, annoyed about what the Marines have been doing, about their study, your public statements, and yet they were the only service, as far as I can tell, doing the hard research on a very, very difficult issue. To me, it seems like you might want to think about complimenting the leadership of the Marine Corps as opposed to implying that they weren't taking this seriously. They were clearly taking it seriously. In my view, they were probably the service that was taking it the most seriously. Let me ask one final question that relates to this. On January 1, you directed the Marines to come up with a detailed plan to integrate boot camp within 15 days. Now, I'm a little biased here, but I think it's commonly known that the Marine Corps probably has the best basic training of any service in the United States military, probably any service in the world. I've been on this committee for a year. I don't think I've seen a more outrageous or ill-advised order from a service secretary to tell the Marines that they're going to take boot camp, which has been honed and put together for the benefit of the American people over decades, and you're going to tell them and order them to get a detailed plan in 15 days? Is that even remotely possible? And why did you issue such an order when nobody on this committee thinks that that was remotely possible to integrate boot camp? Did you read the Kassenbaum-Baker report committee, unanimous committee?
Senator, it was not only possible, but the Marines met that. They had been working on this for months and years, and they
did
always
you read
look
the
at how boot camp is organized. And you'll be happy to know, Senator, that they met that deadline. They fully briefed me on January 14th and
came up with the Marines, a can-do organization.
The Marines are an incredibly capable organization. I'm in awe of the Marine Corps and of individual Marines and the sincerity and the service and the work that they have done on behalf of this country. And as I said in my opening statement, it's the greatest honor of my life to lead the United States Marine Corps and the United States Navy. What we have come to, because the Marines did such a good job of coming up with this, is the Marines have developed a very deliberate plan, a very ordered plan, to begin to look at lessons learned and how they can more fully integrate boot camp to give us better Marines, which they have done. And as Commandant Neller and I have talked about several times, boot camp has changed over and over and over again, and always with the same aim, and that is to make better Marines, to make a better Marine Corps and have a more lethal, more effective Marine Corps.
How does your order square with the Kassenbaum-Baker unanimous committee recommendation on the integration of our boot camps in the military?
Well, Senator, I looked at all sorts of reports, but I also have drawn on my almost 7 years.
It doesn't, does it? I mean, it directly contradicts the unanimous recommendation of that committee, right? Just for the record.
I think that's a completely irrelevant point, Senator.
It's not irrelevant. General Neller, do you think, in your professional opinion, having 14 days, because you were probably, mate, you probably didn't take the day off on New Year's Day because you got an order and you're probably working on it. Do you think having 15 days to put together a detailed plan to integrate Marine Corps boot camp, an issue that has been studied, debated on one of the most incredibly important institutions in the not only the Marine Corps, in my view, the United States military, do you think that was a reasonable request? Sounds like you did it, which doesn't surprise me. That's the Marine Corps ethos. But was that a legitimate request to do that within 14 days? One of the biggest issues I'm sure the Corps as an institution has been struggling with for years, 14 days to do that?
Senator, what we did is we briefed the Secretary on how we do recruit training. And in part of that discussion, I believe, I'm not going to speak for him, but he understands and has a better view of why we do it the way we do it. And as he stated, part of that discussion is that we're always trying to get better, and we will continue to look at ways that we can further improve recruit training. So
you're not answering the question, General. You're not answering Senator Sullivan's question. Repeat the question.
Was it a reasonable order, given the years and years and years that the Marine Corps has been looking at this and studying this, and committees like the Kassenbaum-Baker unanimous committee said it wasn't a good idea to have 14 days to come up with a, quote, detailed plan to integrate Marine Corps boot camp. I just think it was outrageous, but I'm wondering in your professional military judgment.
When we briefed on the 14th, we did not provide a plan to fully integrate recruit training, but talked about how we do conduct recruit training.
Well, it's unfortunate. Your time has expired. Secretary Mabus, this would have been a lot easier if you hadn't called in the press immediately and debunked what many of us view was a legitimate study without even reading it. And I don't believe that you read a 1,000-page document in one day. I'm sorry, but I don't believe it. And so your handling of this issue has really complicated the whole situation for those of us who fully support the integration of women in the military. It was done in a peremptory, go-to-the-media-first fashion. General Neller, I would just like to ask, do you want to, for the record, articulate the concerns that you have about this entire evolution?
Senator, there's a lot of concerns that we've talked about, and General Milley articulated them. There's a lot of things we don't know. I would tell you that one of my biggest concerns is that the perception, which is totally inaccurate, that the Marine Corps doesn't value the service of the females that serve in the Marine Corps. As I stated earlier, we're looking at how we can increase the number of females in the Marine Corps. This is about combat effectiveness. This is about health and welfare of the force. This is about talent management, putting every Marine in the place where they can best contribute. So we've been given an order to integrate. We have, we believe, a fully detailed plan to integrate. We're going to give every Marine the opportunity to compete. We have the standards that we think will allow them to be successful.
I asked if you had concerns, General.
I have concerns about retention. I have concerns about injury rates. I have concerns about propensity to reenlist, career progression. I have concerns about what's going to happen if the numbers are low, which they probably will be at the beginning. But I think the plan that we have, again, I have concerns about things I don't know what the answer are going to be to, Chairman, but I think we have a plan in place to where we can monitor that. And I would ask that we continue to be required to come back to this committee and report on how we're doing on implementation.
Senator Reid.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just Senator Sullivan, I believe that Kassenbaum report was done in 1997?
I believe it was 1998.
1998. So we're looking at an evolving situation. I just want to make that clear in terms of reference to the report. The final point I want to make is that I think what I have discerned from the entire panel is this is going to be a very careful, orchestrated, multi-year process at which will be reviewed, should be reported back to the committee, and that the ultimate test will be the effectiveness of units. And that rationale is because that's what makes Marine regiments work. It's platoons, companies, battalions that function, and that'll be the test. And I think, unless anyone disagrees with me, I will conclude with that point.
I thank the witnesses. The hearing is adjourned.
Thank you.